And I'll now turn the mic over to Dr. Ken Silk. And he really needs no introduction in general, and there's far too much to say about him to do him justice. But for me, what matters most is he's been one of my mentors for more than 25 years, and I've appreciated all the clinical wisdom that I've gained from him, and I'm eager to hear what he has to say about his visit to New Orleans.
That was eloquent, Jim. We're running a little late, so I may cut this short. My plan is to do essentially two things: to show a 5-minute video of New Orleans, kind of a slideshow of New Orleans in the days when the storm arrived, and a couple of days after that, that were put together by an EMT that. From New York City, who was there, and some of the photos you may have seen before, and some might be new, and then talk just for a couple of minutes about some of my thoughts when I was there in December. And at that point in time, there'll be hopefully a slideshow that will automatically run itself, and that will be what St. Bernard Parish looked like 90 days after the storm. And the important point there, it was 90 days after the storm, and that will kind of run automatically behind me, but that's what we saw when we arrived on December 1st. So if we can get this thing to work, see what I can do here. This should be something.
There is a house in New Orleans. They pull the rising sun, and it's been the ruin of many a poor boy. And God, I know I'm one.
I'm only going to take really a couple of minutes because I'd like us to stay on time. But with a little bit of luck, these will kind of move behind me. Automatically, so I won't have to think about them. I was in St. Bernard Parish, just east of New Orleans, that had the same floodwaters that now the infamous Lower Ninth Ward had, but it also had contributions of also levees from the Mississippi broke in seven places and 1 million gallons of gasoline from a Murphy oil storage tank that was moved off its foundations. But I just really want to say a couple of different things. When we arrived there on the December 1st, more than 30 days post-Katrina, what amazed me was two things. It looked like it was yesterday that the storm had arrived the prior day, not 90 days before. And when you, at least in St. Bernard Parish, but this was also true in parts of New Orleans, that it didn't matter what street you were on, and it didn't matter whether you turned right or left, or east or west, north or south, it all looked the same. And you could adapt to the places that you saw, because we commuted back and forth from a boat that we were staying on. But when you went on a new street for the first time, it hit you all over again. So there's that kind of adaptability and assumptions that you make. And how quickly you can adjust to these kinds of things, and yet still the fact that when something then changes in what's become your baseline, it kind of throws you back into realizing where you are and what happened there. I signed up to be a psychiatrist from the very beginning when I signed up in September, and when I arrived and there was a clinic that had actually opened, a clinic with real walls rather than tents the day before I arrived, and showed up at 7 o'clock in the morning and there were patients in the waiting room, but they weren't necessarily ready to see a psychiatrist. They had problems. And there's an old saying that 80% of the patients get better despite what we do. So I lit a candle to that, said a prayer every night, and wrapped my stethoscope around, plugged it into my ears that still hurt because they were not used to it, and did primary care medicine. We had other folks there. Unfortunately, we didn't have a lab or an x-ray, so anybody who was really, really ill needed to go someplace else, and there were some facilities open. But of course, being a psychiatrist, I was interested in the stories that people had to tell. And I just want to say a couple of things in relationship to what Jim had said. People had returned to the parish. No, there were no homes that one could live in. Some were living in campers, some lucky enough to have FEMA trailers, 100% that had been promised by the Thanksgiving, and maybe 20 to 25% were there at the time. And now, at least then, they were being promised by Easter. But folks could tell you stories, and some of the stories were quite amazing. And then they would stop and they would say, but you know, I didn't have it as bad as somebody else. In situations that you could not imagine yourself being in. So the people's resilience, their ability to kind of, and maybe in a defensive way, put their own stories in a relative perspective with everyone else as a kind of a coping mechanism. But the other question that people had was, would the community ever be rebuilt again? And they would come back if they knew other people would come back. But they really didn't want to come back if they felt like they would be the only person on a street or the only house that was rebuilt on a street. So that kind of powerful sense of community that that people had, and that they were hoping to find again if and when that they would return. And most of them were commuting from Slidell or actually Mississippi, Baton Rouge, because there was no running water, there was no sewer, no 911, the kinds of basic things that we take for granted every day. So in that context, if particularly, and other people will be able to talk about this, you know, there were college students who had to flee New Orleans either before or during the storm. And then I was thinking when some of the colleges began to reopen in January, what were they coming back to? Certainly something that was very unfamiliar to what they had been used to and what to expect. And even the ties and the connections that they had made in their university life weren't necessarily going to be there, and things are going to be quite different. But the most powerful thing that I ran into was that people were simply coping. It becomes impossible for us to think about the question about, well, I couldn't conceivably do that. If I had to be in that spot, I just couldn't stand it. And what my 2 weeks there taught me is you can't contemplate being in the spot and figure out how you would cope. But when you're in the spot, you cope. And it was a powerful example of human spirit. And even though I spent 2 weeks down there, I really wasn't coping because I knew that I could leave and resume a life that I have here. But people do make adjustments when those adjustments need to be made. The other thing is, when I signed up to go down in December, my goal was to try and deal with post-traumatic stress disorder because this was going to be 90 days after the storm. There wasn't a lot of post-traumatic anything because it was not post. So that people were still in crisis and still coping. It's when things became kind of chronic. Then they, I'm ignoring that when things become chronic and I don't want to say mundane or routine, but then people can cope. But there's nothing like humor to help people cope. I'm going to try and get out of this now. Okay. Yep. Try to figure out what to do. So it's my pleasure to introduce the person who's the keynote of this morning, Cheryll Bowers-Stephens. She's an MD and an MBA. She's a board-certified child and adolescent psychiatrist who was the commissioner of mental health in the state of Louisiana before Katrina. She currently works as a mental health and organizational development consultant, including executive coaching. She was appointed by former HHS Secretary Tommy Thompson to the Federal Center for Mental Health Services Advisory Council. Maybe that's CMS. I'm never sure if it's CMS? Okay. And Dr. Bowers-Stephens graduated from Spelman College and obtained her MD from LSU in New Orleans, and she holds a master's in business administration from the University of New Orleans. And she will speak to us this morning. I want to make sure I've got this correct. Responding to the mental health needs of college students during disaster. Dr. Bowers-Stephens, my pleasure.
It's a little difficult watching your hometown after this disaster, so I'll try to pull it together and start the presentation. What I'd like to start with, we've had so many films and, you know, we're moving ourselves back into the crisis. I'm going to bring you back to the height of the crisis at Charity Hospital just to give you a sense of what it was like during the crisis and day to day, and then try to bring you forth and to project into the next year and into our recovery, particularly our college students' recovery. Wait a minute. the sound.
I mean, we're basically back to primitive medicine.
In the days after Hurricane Katrina, New Orleans hospitals became fortresses under siege. Doctors and nurses stayed on duty even as conditions grew more and more desperate.
Hospital would have a difficult time in a disaster like this one, even one with the name Charity. At New Orleans' largest public hospital, the goal of the staff today, that nobody dies.
We are their only hope, and we are trying as hard as we can to get them some help.
What's going to happen to some of these patients if you don't get them out of here?
Two of them have already died here on this ramp waiting to get out, in this very spot.
Today is the day to complete this evacuation of our hospitals. My best information from staff inside our hospitals is that in some areas we are out of food and water. Some of my staff are giving each other intravenous nutrition because they are needing to be rehydrated. It has to happen today, I pray for that.
Today, heavily armed officers used airboats to make their way to more than 2,000 people holed up in New Orleans' two state-run hospitals. They've had no power and little food. And with patients dying, doctors have been pleading to get those still alive out.
This water is over 12 feet deep.
The doctor showed us the floodwaters that forced him to move patients in critical condition upstairs, where they turned an auditorium into their emergency room. There are nearly 900 people still inside this hospital. Close to 200 are patients. And for the nurses who continually tried to calm nerves, it was a nearly impossible task.
They stopped believing me, and I stopped believing it.
What did you stop believing?
I stopped believing that anybody was coming for us. And that I wasn't going to get home to see my husband and kids.
Are we ready for boats for the psych patients?
This afternoon, patients began boarding the boats. Dr. W is convinced everyone will be out by tonight.
I'm stunned that more people have died. Stunned.
Even after all of this, we couldn't help but to notice the doctor and his colleagues remained upbeat. As we walked through the hospital, they pointed out a sign on a hospital wall that reads, "Where the unusual occurs and miracles happen."
Because victory today is mine.
Thank you.
So can we believe that in the United States? I mean, that was the state of affairs in New Orleans during this crisis. And probably one of the biggest disasters to hit the United States ever. And it really exposed a lot of the weaknesses of our infrastructure at a city, state, and federal level. And so you know that the hurricane hit on August 29th, 2005. It was designated to be a Category 4 hurricane. As early as the Friday before the hurricane was to hit, it wasn't really thought that it was going to come to New Orleans. It wasn't until Saturday that it became evident and clear that this hurricane was going to hit the state. And at that point, once the governor declared a state of emergency, as you know, public health leaders, we went into a crisis mode and pretty much stayed in that mode for about three months. Now, turning our attention to the college students, New Orleans is a city with a number of historic colleges. We have Loyola University, which is a Catholic college, Dillard University, which is a historically black college and university of the, I believe, the Methodist faith, Tulane University, that you all may be aware of, Xavier University, a historically black college and university that produces more African-American physicians nationally than any other college in the country, is in New Orleans. And then we have the University of New Orleans and then Southern University at New Orleans, which is also a historically black college and university. So a number of universities in the city. And if you remember, that weekend is the weekend that students had arrived to begin college. It is also the weekend that students had left the state and the city to begin college. And so this hurricane hit on a transition weekend for colleges and college students. This is just a picture of the cars as they were leaving the city. And obviously, once students, you know, get to the college becomes their guardian, for lack of a better term. And so it was the college's responsibility to evacuate the students, particularly those students that didn't have family or friends close by. And there were a number of students that had to rely on their respective college for their evacuation. I mean, those that had family members, for instance, I had a niece that was at Xavier University. I went to pick her up on the Saturday before the storm. I told her to pack for 3 days because that's what usually happens, and then she should be back in her dorm room. But for those students that didn't have family or friends that had family, they were evacuated. For instance, these are students that were evacuated from the flooded campus of Dillard University, and they went up to Centenary College in Shreveport sleeping on a gymnasium floor. So imagine yourself as a freshman. It's your first weekend away from home, your first weekend at college, and you have this situation. So from a psychological and psychiatric developmental standpoint, that can have a significant impact, not only currently, but into those individuals' futures. The rainfall after Hurricane Katrina. You know, if this had just been a Category 4 hurricane, we would have bounced back in about 3 days. But with the significant rainfall and the failure of the levees and the breakage of the 17th Street Canal, which became evident sometime between Monday and Tuesday, it was that insult that totally wiped out large parts of New Orleans, not only the Ninth Ward, not only St. Bernard Parish, but areas such as New Orleans East, areas such as what we call Pontchartrain Park, Lakeview. And so this hurricane has really disrupted a large portion of Louisiana's, of New Orleans's society, basically. I mean, it's basically wiped out both the middle class and the lower class in the city. And I don't think people are aware of that, of how significant and pervasive the damage was based on the flooding. This is, just to give you an idea, in New Orleans East, where there was a Six Flags, this is how high the water was at Six Flags. So you can see the, you know, the roller coasters and where the water is on the roller coasters. And so you had entire neighborhoods that were underwater, two hospitals, for-profit hospitals, underwater, out of commission. You had physicians' offices, dental offices, and other businesses that were underwater. This is a picture of the Astrodome, and so where you know a number of individuals were sent actually out of state, and so there were numbers of arenas such as this that were filled with Louisiana citizens for a great deal of time after the storm. Again, this is not a normal living arrangement, so you're going to have psychological and psychiatric complications from this type of evacuation. Again, just to show how high the water was, this is the Mississippi River Bridge. The West Bank of New Orleans was not impacted, but this is how high the water got on the East Bank side. And just a picture of, you know, moving into the, you know, aftermath and recovery of the debris that was collected in the earlier days of the storm. And you'll see piles like this, particularly in the outlying areas, in numerous places, still trying to, you know, get rid of all of the debris from the storm. That's Xavier University, which is in the background after the storm. And so just to bring this, you know, closer to the purpose of this conference as it relates to the college student, I mean, there is a Katrina College diaspora. The storm disrupted the start of school for an estimated 75 to 100,000 students enrolled at more than 30 colleges in the New Orleans area. That's a significant number of kids, and the time that it happened, particularly for freshmen, very critical to their development. I show this picture because the group of kids that we haven't talked about are the kids who are seniors and who will be, you know, entering colleges in the fall. I think that is going to be a high-risk group because their senior year, which is a transitional developmental year, was significantly interrupted during the storm. And I have circled my son, who's number 84, and his best friend, Lewis, number 17, and this is their entire senior football class who had been, you know, looking forward to their senior year all summer, had, you know, had extra practices, so forth and so on. They had their first game the Friday before the storm. So within 1 week, by the Friday after the storm, it became very important for them to continue their, not only their education, but their extracurricular activities. So they went from being the Newman Greenies to the Dunham Tigers all in 1 week, which is a significant transition if you have to think about it, in addition to college preparation. And I can remember, you know, as commissioner at the time, obviously, we relocated to my husband's parents' home in Gonzales, which was about 15 minutes outside of Baton Rouge. My husband, who's the health director of the city of New Orleans, remained in the Superdome. And on Tuesday after the storm, my oldest son said, "Mom, where are we going to go to school?" I said, "What are you talking about?" He says, "Well, I'm on the internet and everybody's enrolling in other schools. Newman is closed and we don't know when it's going to open again." And that's when it first hit me how significant this disaster was and what the impact was going to be, not only on my life, but on the people in New Orleans. And so we had to rush, you know, find a school, reestablish their routine as much as possible. I have a sixth grader and a first grader. I was most concerned about my senior because that is the transition year. That's, you know, you're applying to colleges. And I can remember when we left the house, you know, I told them the same thing, just pack enough for about 3 days. I got in the car, then I thought about it. I said, well, you know, I thought, you know, well, it may not be 3 days. And so I told them to go back in to get, you know, anything that was significant to them in case we were going to be gone for longer. And the senior brought his college applications, all the stuff he had been working on a CD-ROM, which became very significant because there was a lot of difficulties with the seniors in their college applications. And so I think as you all are all coming from counseling centers and colleges, I think this class that's going to arrive next year, those that are from New Orleans and that were impacted by the storm, I think there needs to be some early preparation for dealing with any issues that may emerge during that first year. Now, when we talk about the impact of disasters, I know we've talked a lot about this up to this point, but this is a developmental time for students, particularly for, again, your seniors in high school and then your freshmen. This is the beginning of their transition from adolescence to young adulthood. And so if we take ourselves back to, you know, early developmental theories and we think about, you know, each, you know, level of development and from various perspectives, we can begin to see how important and critical it will be to have, you know, programs in place, counseling in place, and other things in place to begin to address the needs of these students. From a biological perspective, you know, most of these kids are going to have reached Piaget's level of formal operation. You know, those whose senior year was disruptive, you know, may not have been able to get adequately their final, you know, academic preparation for college. Also during college and during that age is where you have the onset of major psychiatric disorders, where you will see the onset of bipolar. You may see the onset of schizophrenia. And for those individuals, you know, going back to the lecture we heard yesterday, in terms of resilience, for those individuals that had been impacted or their families impacted by this storm, that may have some genetic vulnerabilities, you may see an increased level of depression, anxiety, and or post-traumatic stress disorder. And I think because of the prolonged nature of this disaster, you know, Dr. Silk said it earlier, 90 days after, we were still in an acute situation, so you would still expect to see a lot of acute stress disorder. And so I believe that the onset of post-traumatic stress disorder post-Katrina, we're going to see it rise for months and years to come because of the prolonged nature of the exposure to the trauma. From a psychological standpoint, I know we don't want to go back to Freud, but I just saw something in the airport, a major newspaper, Freud is not dead. But we can also remember, you know, psychosexual development, the id versus the ego, where students, particularly those that are leaving home, are for the first time going to have to set their own rules, and they have that struggle going on. It's also a time for healthy risk-taking. So the freshmen that come onto your colleges, I believe those that have been very stressed either during that senior year or continue to be stressed because of environmental issues or, you know, the what impact that the storm had on their particular family members may be more prone to risk-taking. And, you know, we may see, you know, substance abuse issues and other consequences of unhealthy risk-taking. And then when we look at a sociological standpoint, and we go back to social learning theory, and we look at the impact of this disaster not only on individuals that were directly impacted, but the society at large, you know, through the media, and what impact that will have on the major task during college for kids to really individuate and begin to develop their own sense of self, their, you know, mastery of whatever their, you know, life profession is going to be in their development. And so, you know, basically, for these kids, you know, some of the dreams that they may have had, you know, some of the beginnings of them formulating, you know, what they wanted to do with their life, depending on how they were impacted, how their family was impacted, how much of their normal routine was able to be maintained. It could have a long-lasting impact on their future. And I know I have a friend of mine that lives down the street from me, and during the storm, she had just brought her daughter to Georgetown. Her daughter was a freshman at Georgetown and really began to experience difficulties in school because what the kids would do that were from New Orleans, they would get together and just watch television. And so all that they knew about what was going on was what they saw through the media. And of course, the telephones didn't work. There were no computers. And so the learning experience was significantly interrupted, as well as the ability to begin that individuation process. And so for many of these kids, they're going to be the ones of I'm confused. There may be more confusion and more difficulty transitioning. And so from a preventive standpoint, if there can be things that the colleges can do to offset that and have that planned ahead of time, particularly for the incoming freshmen and even your rising sophomores, juniors, and seniors, because, you know, just like in any other public health setting, some kids, they're not going to come forth. They could go unnoticed. And so just, you know, like you take a public health approach, there may have to be some proactive activities and things that are done to take in consideration some of the internal struggles that these students may be going through. So the mental health issues that are common with traumatic events. We heard a lot yesterday about acute stress disorder, and I believe that developmentally, the people who are still in the city are just coming out of that phase of acute stress, and some of them are still in acute stress. As one of my colleagues has stated, for some people, every day is like the day after the storm. We still have people living in shelters, with people with no living arrangements. There's still kids out of school. And so for some people, they're still in the acute phases of this particular disaster. We're seeing a lot of anxiety and depression. The substance abuse and alcohol use, there's not a lot of data that has documented the increase of substance abuse and alcohol use, but we anticipate that that may be a problem. And then we know that during disasters and post-disasters, you have an increase in domestic violence. And so on the college campuses, for those colleges in New Orleans, obviously they're going to need to be able to be prepared to deal with acute stress disorder. But for those of you who have students that are from the New Orleans area that may have gone home for Christmas, that went home for spring break, they may come back with some signs and symptoms of acute stress just from, you know, driving around. Because those of us who are there, obviously we're adapting to the environment. But if you come there and you haven't been there since August, there are significant dramatic changes that seeing those things for the first time could, you know, cause some acute stress in the students that you have from New Orleans. The emergence of post-traumatic stress, anxiety, depression, and, probably not domestic violence, but those kids that are having real difficulties in their separation individuation areas and where they're acting those out in relationships, that you may see, abuse or physical abuse, sexual abuse, sexual trauma in, you know, in relationships. The symptoms of PTSD, I put up here the types of behaviors that you usually would see in children. And I did that because, you know, if you believe in developmental theory being a trajectory, you may have some students that, although they're, you know, 18, 19 years old, depending on where they are developmentally, depending on how well they have individuated from their families, may begin to experience some turmoil. So I want to remind us what, from a child's standpoint, what sorts of symptoms that are seen. Refusal to return to school and clinging behavior, avoidance behaviors, and so you may see these students going back home more than usual, or you know, spending so much time thinking about home that they're not able to focus on their studies. Persistent fears related to the catastrophe, fears about being separated from the parents. So if you know, if there's a major rain, or if there's a tornado watch, or you know, watching of the Weather Channel to make sure that people at home are okay. You know, we still see frequent reports in the media about New Orleans and Hurricane Katrina. Those things can have impact on your students that are from New Orleans. Sleep disturbances, nightmares, screaming during their sleep. You know, bedwetting in children, but that can also re-arise in, you know, young adults or adults. So for your hall monitors or your PAs in the dorms, they may have to be trained to look for some of these symptoms, because these people, you know, typically I wouldn't think a college student would self-identify with having some of these difficulties. Loss of concentration and irritability, behavioral problems, physical complaints. You may have an increased presentation to your health section with, you know, physical complaints that are really secondary to anxiety. And then withdrawal from family and friends and preoccupation with the events of the disaster. And I put these up here because I think it would be important to make sure that your teachers, particularly those who are not psychologically minded or you know, interested in psychiatry, and then for your hall monitors, from a preventive standpoint, it would be important to make sure that there's some in-service and some trainings to be able to identify students that may be having difficulties. This is just a slide that just reminds us that both, you can have depression by itself, you can have post-traumatic stress disorder by itself, but in some individuals you can have a combination of PTSD and depression. And those are going to be the youth that are at most risk and may not self-identify. Now, the Katrina's impact on the mental health system in Louisiana. We estimate that about 3.2 million individuals will be in need of crisis counseling services. There were over a million registrations that had been submitted to FEMA, and the CDC did a preliminary population needs assessment that showed, you know, with the significant loss of homes, with overcrowding living situations, with a significant economic loss. And this is also going to be an impact on your students, because families that prior to Katrina could have, you know, could afford to help and support their children through college, quite frankly, at this point, may not be able to do so. And so that's going to be another stressor on the college student. Significant economic loss, chronic health concerns. But what was most significant in the study that CDC did was that over 50% of the people that they surveyed within households said that they were in need of mental health counseling. And so I would expect that in your college counseling programs that you should have kids, particularly from the New Orleans area, coming for some level of counseling. My concern are for those kids who are not going to self-identify, what are going to be your strategies for reaching out and approaching those youth? The DeWolf disaster population model, this is just to remind us that that in these disasters, it's not only the immediate, the people who are just there that are impacted. You have your first responders, and then you have the community at large, mental health providers, the government officials. We've had a lot of people come from out of state, in state. Those individuals are vulnerable and are going to be in need of counseling. The large group of college students that came in for spring break, you all need to be prepared to be able to process with them, or, you know, debrief, depending on, you know, how you feel about that, or what your college's policy is on that. But I think that the colleges need to have some sort of preventive intervention in place to talk to and discuss with the students that went to New Orleans for spring break. The severity of Katrina's impact, I think we saw some of these figures yesterday, but 5 to 10% of the affected population will experience clinically significant issues as a result of the event. An additional 5 to 10% will experience issues that are subclinical but require support. And in the severely exposed communities, which is the majority of the New Orleans area, 25 to 30% of the population will experience significant issues. An additional 10 to 20 will fall into the subclinical category. That's a high number of individuals. And, you know, yesterday in the talk on epidemiology, I'd like to personally invite the presenter to come to New Orleans to begin to study the New Orleans impact, because I think that the characteristics of Katrina are much different from the characteristics of 9/11 and some of the other disasters that have been studied in the past. And this may be one of our few attempts within the United States to get a glimpse into the impact of a natural disaster within the United States. General disaster psychiatry, this is just to remind you that that disaster psychiatry is different from trauma psychiatry, which is different from general psychiatry. So the types of techniques that you use in your regular mental health counseling program may not be sufficient to deal with the individuals that have been impacted by this trauma or other traumas that you experience at your college. And when we look at the definition of disaster, where there's a severe disruption, ecological and psychosocial, which greatly exceeds the coping of the affected community, this is not just an individual, these types of events, Katrina, didn't just impact people at the individual level. It very much impacted the community and all those involved. And when we look at our man-made disaster versus our natural disasters versus our technological disasters, Katrina had characteristics of all three. It was man-made in that it was a hurricane, you know, it was a level 4 hurricane, but the levee system failed, and that is both a man-made error and a technological error, in addition to a natural disaster. And I don't know of many other disasters that have those characteristics. And so our disaster response system has to be modified in order to take those things into account. And so a lot of the blame that we have on, you know, the feds and the governor, the mayor, a lot of it has to do with the fact that the country was not really prepared for a disaster of this particular magnitude. But I think that this was a wake-up call to all of us, particularly those of us who are administrators in any system that you run, whether it be a state system or a college system, to make sure that you have disaster response plans in place, and that you have a plan in place that takes into consideration the worst case scenario, because it could happen. The mental health aftermath of Katrina, I mean, this is probably just a summary of things that you all have heard over the past day or so. Post-traumatic stress, major depression, and other anxiety problems. Suicide, I have a question mark there, because there has been a reported increase in suicide in the New Orleans area, particularly amongst professionals and first responders. However, when we look at the data from the coroner, it doesn't exactly pan out. And that's probably because of insurance reasons that some things that actually are suicides may not be reported as suicides. And how people in communities respond to and recover from the man-made and natural disasters may differ. How different cultural groups respond to disasters may also be different, which is why it's important to study how those individuals in New Orleans within the United States have responded to the disaster. And the predictive factors as it relates to the severity of the impact are going to be based on, one, the presence of violence. We know that there was a presence of violence during Katrina. The predictability of the event. You know, we anticipated a level 4 or 5 hurricane to hit the city. What we did not anticipate as a general public was the breakage of the 17th Street Canal and the impact of that flooding. And so there was a high level of unpredictability as it relates to this disaster. The duration, again, I think longer than it begins to take on characteristics of war because of the prolonged exposure to the stressor, and then the sense of control. There was obviously a lack of sense of control at every level as it relates to the response to this disaster. So I'm saying that just again to drive home the fact of what we can expect the consequences or sequelae of this disaster to be, particularly from a psychiatric and psychological standpoint. This is a study that the individuals who did this are actually here, David Schwab and Barbara Schwab, who did a study on the effects of Hurricane Katrina on displaced versus regular college students. And I'd like to encourage them to expand that study to include other colleges other than the Southeastern where they are currently. But what they have done a really good job at is looking at all of the different areas where there can be an impact and what those and the significance of those. You know, damages to their place of residence, close friends or relations missing, new family members or friends who had died, lost their home, general decline in health, poor eating habits, felt stressed out, sleep difficulties, nervous and anxious, depressed, which we would expect, religion and faith being important to coping, negative effects on academic performance, decrease in their motivation to study and achieve, withdrawal from classes, and then increases about worrying about financing their college education. I think that these items could be used to work with your PAs in the dormitories to begin to identify those individuals that, again, are not going to self-present. Common responses to disasters and its consequences, during the disaster, disbelief and shock, fear and anxiety about the future, disorientation, inability to focus on schoolwork, apathy and emotional numbing, irritability and anger, mood swings, sadness and depression, the feelings of powerlessness, extreme changes in eating habits, crying for no apparent reason, headache and stomach problems, difficulty sleeping, excessive use of alcohol and drugs. These are the things that students need to be aware of and that your teachers and your and anybody else that interacts with the students, and done on your college campuses in a public health manner where it's done through some sort of a marketing approach, I think would be good to do. The clinical implications of Katrina. There's a lot of debate within this field of disaster mental health or disaster psychiatry that I personally wasn't aware of until Katrina hit. And one is, what is the best type of support to provide during a crisis? And so I think it would be very wise for each college center to really analyze and look at that data and research and come up with a policy, because you don't want to be making those decisions during the crisis, because you're going to have people calling from many different places offering to do a specific type of intervention, and then some other group calling saying, you know, that's not the thing to do. And so I think it needs to be decided ahead of time what types of interventions, based on your own, look at the research and literature that you would like to provide as it relates to psychological first aid. I think what we do know and what we can generalize is that having some type of intervention during that immediate time, during the acute stress time, can prevent psychiatric morbidity, can prevent problems down the line. And so we have to do something, but I think the consensus on what we have to do needs to be developed by each individual entity or agency prior to a disaster. Short-term medication from the neurobiologic information that we saw yesterday and other studies that have been done, giving some type of medication during the disaster may be beneficial in preventing long-term side effects. We know that cognitive behavioral therapy is the intervention of choice as it relates to post-traumatic stress disorder from a psychological perspective, in addition to or without medication. And so having therapists available that are trained in cognitive behavioral therapy is important. And not that many people are really trained in these techniques. And it is an evidence-based intervention. It's one that's been studied, and it's one that's known to work. And so another area of training and prevention that college programs or counseling programs can do is to make sure that your counselors are trained in cognitive behavioral therapy, supportive therapeutic techniques that most of us are trained in. The debriefing groups, again, that's another area of controversy within the field of disaster mental health. And so, examine the literature and come up with some recommendation that you feel comfortable with at your respective college. A media advisor. Very important during a disaster. What gets into the media, who gets into the media, and what is portrayed in the media. Those things need to be thought out ahead of time. And it's very important from a systemic standpoint, whatever your disaster response plan is, that you have a systematic link of whatever your first aid intervention is going to be, what your evaluation is going to be. Because if you have a high level of presentation that, like what happened at LSU, University of Michigan, if there was something that happened in Detroit, could become the site that has to triage, all of these mental health clients. You don't want to wait till you're in the middle of the emergency to develop the types of evaluations and interventions that you're going to use. Crisis counseling, again, the definition of that is, varies from group to group. However, we do know that some sort of counseling, short term, from 2 to 3 months, can be preventive in problems developing down the road. It's important to have education, counseling, and support, to listen, validate, and allow questions, and to have some type of formalized training prior to the disaster, so that you know that your clinicians are trained in this particular area before the disaster occurs. I just want to give you a picture of what we did in the Office of Mental Health when I was commissioner as it relates to disaster preparedness for mental health, and that we were actually in a good spot to be able to deploy people that had been trained. And so we provided mental health supports to every level of the crisis response system. We also had a disaster response plan for each of our state mental hospitals. Our state mental hospitals were evacuated Saturday before the storm, and we lost no patients and without event. And that was because we had planned prior. We had disaster response drills, which is not a bad idea, given what we've learned from Katrina. For any entity, whether it be your crisis counseling system, your college, to have a plan of evacuation and have practiced that on some level at least once. We had 4,000 employees trained in 2004 in disaster mental health, and in May of 2005, almost prophetically, we worked with the LSU Department of Psychiatry. And we trained individuals in all hazards response planning, which is different than, just planning for a hurricane. crisis counseling and intervention with special populations, and disaster mental health interventions and incidents involving mass casualties. Now, you wouldn't expect that from a hurricane, but those, if you saw from what happened at Charity, it turned into that type of disaster and crisis. And so we had individuals trained prior that we could deploy into these settings. And I don't think that's a bad idea, again, for any other large entity to at least have people trained and ready for deployment. So this is almost the last slide, and this sort of puts everything that we've talked about over the last day in a nutshell. I believed at that moment that I was about to die. I was terrified. And what you saw in the film from what happened at Charity, that was happening in many different places around the state. It was happening on a community level. It was happening on a family level. It was happening on a personal level. And it's going to take some time to get back to normal. Psychotherapy might help. It's going to take a while for New Orleans to recover. It's going to take at least 10 years for New Orleans to recover from this, from this insult. And so we're not expecting, dramatic and quick improvements because of the significance and level of the impact. And what we learned, our lessons learned. One of the biggest lessons that I learned as an administrator, and I'd like for you to take home, is that each and every one of you as administrators, your middle management, we all need to be trained in incident command structure. How to bring order from an administrative standpoint during a process such as this. I just think that's very important. A lot of the problems that we had was because we weren't able to properly implement from, the governor's level down that incident command structure. And so we need to have been trained in that, and we need to have practiced that prior to the disaster. Planning. You need to have a written plan that everybody has agreed upon, memorandums of understanding in place, and prepare for the worst scenario. Training implications, and this is something that's very easy to do, making sure that, particularly in your counseling program, that people are trained in the proper interventions and that you as a system have come to some consensus. You don't want your psychologists and psychiatrists fighting over what type of intervention you're going to use, over what, experts you're going to have come in. During the disaster is not the time for that. And there was a lot of that going on, But if you have your incident command structure in place, if you have already come to, a decision on, what you're going to use, who your outside experts are going to be, things are going to go much smoother, and you'll feel more in control of the situation. And then the long-term impact. I think as universities, I think that you all, we have a responsibility to research and study what has happened and what the consequences are. So there are a number of topics of research. I know we have a number of people here who are researchers or who know researchers. There are a number of topics that I think are worthy of exploration. Epidemiology I have here is number one. There's really not a lot out there to help to guide you on what to expect from an evidence-based perspective as it relates to the numbers of people with post-traumatic stress, the numbers with depression, when it occurs. There's really not a lot out there to guide people on the ground from that perspective. Studies on resilience, I put this up even before yesterday, which was the highlight talk for me, which is very important, because some people are going to make it through this just fine, but you have others that are struggling and just might not make it through. Ethnocultural studies, for anthropology, this is a study that may not come again. What happens when a whole city culture is destroyed, and how can you maintain that type of culture? How do you redevelop a city within the United States? I consider myself living in a developing city. That's what it feels like. So I think that needs to be studied. Behavioral data related to drug and alcohol use post-disasters. The literature is very, there's a lot of debate on whether or not it goes up or down. For funding purposes, we need to have that information. And then planning and design of college counseling programs informed by the research. I mean, at some point, and we talked about this last night, I think within that field of disaster mental health, we need to come to a consensus on what works, what doesn't work, what makes things worse. I think it's prudent for us to come together as a group, but from the people I talked to last night, that right now we're not at a point for that to happen. I think it then becomes the individual responsibility of each entity to make that decision, because you don't want to have to make those decisions in the middle of the crisis. And just some positive news as it relates to college students. As of January, nearly 90% of students returned to Tulane for the winter semester. And Tulane is in that corridor of the city that is furthest along in its redevelopment. You know, Uptown, Magazine Street, the French Quarter, and areas of the West Bank are, you know, highly populated. And they're not back to normal, but they're much further along than the pictures that you all saw earlier of St. Bernard. We have 81% of Loyola students are back, which is right next door to Tulane. We have 76% of Xavier students who are back, and they're back in their dorms, on their campuses. And that's a very important university because, like I said before, it produces the highest number of African American physicians of any college in the country. And so they're back on target. And then Dillard University, which was most damaged by the hurricane, saw half of its student body return. Now, it was in the 7th Ward, which is how the city developed going toward the east. So it was significantly damaged. And they're holding their classes out of the faculty are staying at the Hilton, and they have their classes at the World Trade Center. So they have about half of their student body. And so that's as of March the 6th. So those colleges are operating. So that's a positive note. And so that concludes my talk.
So people who were here yesterday, if you have a question or a comment, we'll do about 5 or 6 minutes. There's another one there. Should we also, question, should we also be looking for clinically significant issues in future students who will be entering college 3 to 4 years from now?
I would say yes, particularly those kids that were in, you know, transition times, like ninth graders, kids entering middle school. We're seeing a lot of separation anxiety in our kindergarten, first and second graders. And so depending on how those issues get resolved, when they hit college, which is another developmental year, you know, you have to go back and remaster those things that you didn't master earlier on. And so I would say yes. I would have some kind of program or something in place in general to handle those issues.
What do you expect will be the impact on New Orleans area college students, one, on the anniversary of Katrina, and two, if there's another major hurricane this season?
Well, if there's
and is anybody planning for this?
Well, obviously, yes, they are planning for it. You know, one thing that's going to be an issue as of June 1st, when hurricane season starts, the mayor has announced that there will be no shelter of last resort, which means that from a community standpoint, where we probably have global post-traumatic stress disorder, the first major hurricane that looks like it's heading our way, you're going to see a massive exodus of the city. And so for the college student, I mean, what are we going to do? Prearrange for students to be enrolled at some other college? I think that is going to be an issue, particularly if you know, if something similar happens and the if the hurricane comes from the opposite direction, hits the West Bank, you could have a similar impact on the areas of the city that were not impacted initially. And so, yes, we do need to plan for that, and I anticipate that there are going to be a number of mass evacuations of the city during this next hurricane season, which can cause anxiety to the students who are from that area or have friends or family in that area.
I have the mic right now. I have a question for you. We know that the mental health of student populations and, frankly, everyone, depression, sleep, depression, stress, post-traumatic stress disorder, anxiety, all of these are accentuated by sleep disruptions and poor sleep hygiene. Did anyone look at any of those variables in the people in the community and college students, and were there any special attempts to almost try to teach sleep hygiene? How do you manage to get some sleep that's normal and decent during times of crisis and disaster? And should we be doing that?
Yeah, I know. We looked at sleep disturbance in the CDC study. However, to my knowledge, there are no public health announcements or promotions of sleep hygiene. That's a good idea. That's a very good idea. Maybe University of Michigan can do that.
Thank you very much.
Okay.